Hi, this is Herb Kressel, and welcome to the Radiology Podcast. Today I'm joined by Dr. Pascal Baltzer, who is Associate Professor of Radiology at the Allgemeiner Krankenhaus in Vienna, and on the faculty of the Medical University of Vienna. Welcome, Dr. Baltzer.
Thank you, Dr. Kressel. It's great to be online here with you.
Great. Well, Dr. Baltzer and his colleague authored a paper entitled MRI for the Diagnosis of Malignancy in Mammographic Microcalcifications, a Systematic Review and Meta-Analysis. And I found the paper quite interesting, as it kind of moves us along the way of personalized or precision medicine, further refining how we might use our tools. So, Dr. Baltzer, what was the rationale for the study? Why did you and your colleagues decide to look at this question?
Well, the first idea was to really assess the diagnostic performance of breast MRI in general, because there was quite some discussion and controversies about that. Very, very quickly, we came to the thing that, well, actually, we have to distinguish between lesions presenting as microcalcifications on mammography and lesions not presenting as microcalcifications on mammography. The idea would be, as my mammography obviously detects microcalcifications and that does it very good, and MRI cannot detect microcalcifications, whether MRI has any value here. What we know, on the other hand, is that microcalcifications detected by mammography are not malignant in the majority of cases, so there's a huge potential to reduce the number of unnecessary biopsies here. And that was the reason why we focused on the specific entity of lesions presenting as mammographic microcalcifications. And yeah, that's it.
So I understand that having a biopsy is physically and emotionally traumatic. But on the other hand, it also resolves the question to some extent. And so for some patients, the extended worry time where you have this suspicious finding is also problematic. So why do you think that short-term follow-up and biopsy isn't a good way to follow these people?
Well, the one thing is, I think we're also talking, of course, now about health politics, because the time, how long I have to wait, for instance, for the biopsy or the MRI depends on how available those tests are. And that was really generally, if the test is good, obviously, I do not need another test if the patient waits like 2 months for it. That's obviously clear. However, it is really like that. First, the biopsy, of course, is costly. For instance, which is quite interesting, in Austria, the biopsy is more expensive than the MRI. But of course, that's insurance and health politics. But then the biopsy, and especially the vacuum-assisted biopsy, that is the standard of choice for biopsying microcalcifications, is quite invasive. So although we do not have complications that need to be treated surgically, we have obviously, and at least I think in about one third of the patients, really a hematoma, which even presents as a lesion. So the patient, it was biopsied due to a non-palpable lesion, feels a palpable lump afterwards. This is really a stressful concept.
Okay.
You talk to the patient, so that's one of the reasons why we think about using a non-invasive test to clarify the situation here.
So you and your colleague performed a systematic review and meta-analysis. Can you tell us why you decided this route to try to answer this question, and what exactly did you do in your study?
So, well, my point of view before I'm doing one study is to check the literature, of course, which I think should be obviously done. And I, in recent years, have stick to the procedure of doing a systematic review and meta-analysis. First, to see whether something has been done already, and then to get an impression how heterogeneous the results are. So, are there reasons why groups are performing better or non-better? And what's the current status on this? And in many, many cases, there already has been enough literature or enough data has been accumulated. And so a meta-analysis, for me, is the first choice to assess the current status and to identify fields and research gaps where we should work on.
I see. And so when you looked at this problem, what did you think was the quality of the studies that were available?
So basically, we did a GRADIS assessment or GRADIS 2 assessment, and found that that all studies we identified, that the 20 studies that met the inclusion criteria were actually were applicable to resolve the research questions, and that just in some studies we had a questionable risk of bias. We had no studies where we deemed the risk of bias high. Obviously, and I personally think that always this risk of bias assessment has some problems, because the specific research question, of course, if for instance some specific sub methods are not given, for instance how the images are read, then of course there might be some bias we have to probe by sub analysis. So in this case, we deemed the studies after checking them fully applicable to solve the research questions, although of course not all studies answered all the questions we were interested in.
And although your focus was looking at the BI-RADS categories, not all the studies actually reported BI-RADS categories. So how did you deal with that problem?
So it was really first of all, the inclusion criteria studies that examined the value of MRI to resolve or to diagnose malignancy in mammographic microcalcifications. And of course, we were interested in this subgroup. So if the reason for referral, is it a BI-RADS-3, questionable whether there even should be BI-RADS-3 microcalcifications, BI-RADS-4 microcalcification, or BI-RADS-5 microcalcification. Again, the revised BI-RADS rather questions that there is a BI-RADS-5 category for microcalcifications. Nevertheless, this study was first to estimate the diagnostic performance of MRI sensitivity and specificity for microcalcifications, and then use subgroup analysis, for instance, due to BI-RADS referral categories, in order to have the lesion stratified not according to the category, and of course also according to the prevalence of malignancy.
Okay, so that by creating these subcategories, you could have sort of a more homogeneous data set to kind of look at.
Yeah.
What were your key findings? You looked at 20 studies. I think they had over 1,400 lesions that were included. And what did you find?
So, well, the first and most interesting finding is what also seems to apply in non-calcified lesions. Invasive cancer can be excluded with a negative predictive value of about 99%. So there, MRI is quite accurate. That's what all fans of MRI always say since 20 years. That's where MRI is valuable. It can exclude invasive cancer. Regarding general malignancy, MRI does not perform that good. The negative predictive value in general is about 90%, which is good, but not perfect. But it is also quite specific. So there's a solid diagnostic performance for all lesions, which is much better if I want to just exclude invasive cancer.
I see. Okay. Now, you have a couple of interesting findings, but I wanted to ask you about the high heterogeneity index that you identified. In our journal, we struggle with this. Imaging studies are frequently very, very heterogeneous. And my own experience with meta-analysis is sort of like you were describing. When you start kind of looking under the hood, as we say, all of a sudden you see a lot of questions about what was reported, how terms were used, and there is frequently a lot of heterogeneity in the studies that we see. So how do you view this, and how should readers who read the paper think about the heterogeneity in the studies?
So first of all, that's really probably the most important question. First of all, heterogeneity is really an issue, as you pointed out. Heterogeneity strongly hints at what we know, that breast MRI is a bit more difficult to interpret than a mammogram. Training is not that, has not the same level, we have not the same quality standards, and for sure we do not have the same diagnostic criteria applied. For instance, some authors may just use the presence of enhancement as a criterion, and if anything enhances, they biopsy it. Some authors use more sophisticated criteria that will lead to a threshold effect, meaning that sensitivity may go down, but specificity goes up. We tried to answer this not so generally. If heterogeneity is too high, you and no one should pool the data. Should not give summary estimates. Mm-hmm. What I think is most important is to identify subgroups that are less heterogeneous, and that was basically how we dealt with it. And I think as the main question here was to exclude malignancy, we just summed up the raw findings, especially regarding missed cancers stratified by DCIS and invasive malignancies, for every single study, so every reader can have a view. One of the main reasons for heterogeneity in this study, however, has not directly to do or indirectly to do just with diagnostic performance. That was the heterogeneous prevalence of malignancy. And if the prevalence of malignancy differs, you have really to you add an order of magnitude in your heterogeneity, and that obviously says that the included studies, and that is of course probably the most important risk of bias, that these studies did not include all the consecutive microcalcification cases as mandated, but some not, that are selected cases.
I see. Now, if I recall correctly, the two things that were the take-home lessons were that MRI was particularly helpful for the BI-RADS-4 type lesions. Perhaps you could speak a little bit about that, but it was surprisingly not helpful for the BI-RADS-3. So perhaps you could go into a little more detail onto sort of how you explain those results.
Well, regarding BI-RADS-4, I think that's the main entity of microcalcifications where we would like to apply MRI, especially as, for instance, if these are multiple lesions. And that's, of course, exactly the same reason why BI-RADS-3 microcalcifications may undergo MRI, because there may be several clusters or even bilaterally. So I want to know, should I, or and if so, where should I do the biopsy? I think the diagnostic performance of BI-RADS-3 microcalcifications, and there are lack of data, so this is a bit speculative, maybe that these are microcalcifications that do not look too suspicious. And I think MRI is prone to miss, of course, a number of cancers that do not enhance, mm-hmm. or just very subtly. So if cancers enhance very subtly, I will miss them, or yeah. If it's just a subtle enhancement, and this may be the case here. We may discuss whether we reduce the number of overdiagnoses here, like it's a big discussion in prostate MRI, where we say, well, the lesions I do not detect by MRI are irrelevant. I think that there it's a common ground. Yeah. In breast imaging, not that much. And then we have to limit that in BI-RADS-3 microcalcifications. Really, the data was limited and even more heterogeneous. In BI-RADS-4 microcalcifications, however, we found the best diagnostic indices. And again, also speculative, because these were two different sub-analyses. In one sub-analysis, we also found where we investigated the diagnostic criteria to apply. We found that really the presence of enhancement is the most sensitive feature here. So if I got a BI-RADS-4 microcalcification and there is no enhancement in the site, that actually should exclude cancer quite accurately.
Yeah, so that I think could be a very helpful finding in the right subgroup of patients. I agree. Now, the poor performance in the BI-RADS-3, do you think some of it is just inter-observer variability in how they're using BI-RADS-3, or you didn't really have access to looking at the microcalcifications in these patients?
Actually, yes. I even remember one of the studies, I should not name it, which was quite interesting. I was just, when I reviewed the paper, one of those papers on BI-RADS-3 microcalcifications, obviously, as in many papers, the authors had imaging examples. Yes. And one of their example for a false negative case was actually, they pictured it, they printed the picture, was a subtle, something we would call in mammography a minimal sign of malignancy. So I think that it's really, it's about the criteria applied. And I think especially in viral 3 microcalcifications, it may be very difficult so that the community that has not really found a common set of criteria to diagnose malignancy here. I think that's the main problem in viral 3. Because specificity also in our summary estimates, especially specificity was very, very low. So here it may not be enough just to call any enhancement suspicious or the absence of enhancement suspicious, because then I would do a number of unnecessary biopsies. So I think this is just an unresolved issue here.
Yes. So thank you. This is all very instructive. Now, have you changed your practice at the University of Vienna, or do you have some further research in mind to pursue this area of MRI in patients with microcalcifications? What are the next steps for you?
Actually, yes. What we found in our meta-analysis was actually research gaps regarding the points already outlined. That is, which microcalcifications or which patients with microcalcifications will profit from the MRI scan. For instance, which BI-RADS, is BI-RADS 4A, B, C, whatsoever, and what diagnostic criteria should be applied. And we are actually working on both fields, trying to do an MRI scan in any patients with microcalcifications scheduled for a vacuum-assisted breast biopsy. The thing in also in this really specific situation is that here really the cost for the MRI, for the problem-solving MRI, they are covered by the official insurance systems, and MRI is really cheaper than the biopsy. So we're in a very lucky position here.
Good. Well, Dr. Baltzer, I want to thank you for sharing the paper with us and for taking the time to participate in the podcast. It's been a pleasure speaking with you.
Thank you very much. It was an honor.
Bye-bye.
Bye.